Yeah, yeah.
The city, I think, might have. Blake couldn't find anything. I was getting some fire tomorrow.
I spent 2 hours down here. Because they ran out to the street and then they go.
It's always fun.
I think they named the town hall survey for you.
Really?
I think I did. I thought I read it. Yeah, I know. Thank you. Can we have a roll call, please?
Dennison?
Here.
Weeden? Gianski?
Yes.
Money?
Present.
Swem?
Here.
Milliporn?
Thank you. Someone like to make a motion to approve the agenda?
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Is there support?
Money, I'll support.
I have a comment. Do I need to move something out of the consent calendar now? What do you want me to wait?
This would be the time.
This would probably be the time.
Yeah.
I want to, we've done this a couple times, so you want to move it down to new business, Kevin?
You're going to need a motion to move. Which part are you wanting?
What do you want?
Yeah.
I'm going to move the plan commission and consider approving Peter Lissy and for a partial term and Jacob Brown for a partial term.
You want it under new business, under, sorry, well, it would be A.
Okay.
Would that be your motion?
That would be my motion.
So you have a motion to move it to where?
Do I even need the motion? Do I need, I don't need to make a motion to move it.
To move it.
I can just ask to move it. Correct?
No, I don't believe so. I believe you need a motion. Because it's already under the consent agenda.
Yeah, but I want to discuss something. I can ask.
You can discuss it right now since there's a motion on the floor. See what I'm saying?
Yeah, you got to ask support for the motion.
Yeah, once, but you already have a motion on the floor right now for approval of the agenda. You have a motion and support right now for that.
But we haven't approved the consent calendar yet.
You have not. But you're motioning to make a motion, you're making a motion to remove the planning commission appointments to new business. You're going to need a session.
Or do you want to just add what you're talking to the agenda under? Are you wanting to move something that impacts those appointments, or do you want to talk about something else?
No, I want to change so that we can discuss it and make a separate motion altogether for the appointments.
Okay.
Then move it to new business.
Okay, so that's my motion that's on the floor. I need a second.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like somebody to second it and vote on why, you know, at least
commentary in here. We have, if we're gonna add something underneath this, since we have to do it now.
Right.
We can discuss it, but we essentially, we need to add it to the agenda to approve the agenda.
That's professional right there, so.
I would say it would be an amendment to the agenda.
Yes.
Okay.
So we amend the agenda.
So, yes.
Dan wants to amend the.
You have the motion, but Dan is asking for a new motion to amend the agenda.
And if I would've done that, if I would've done that for clarity, before there's a motion on the floor to approve the agenda, can I do that?
You can do that right now if you want.
No, I mean, now, wait a minute, let me ask a question.
But I already have a motion, I hear it.
Right, if there was no motion to approve the agenda, and I asked to move something off the consent calendar, I wouldn't need a motion. So I would be able to ask for that as a commissioner, which every commissioner has the right, I believe.
So, I think the easiest way to do this, Dan, is, we all know what you wanna talk about, I think the easiest thing to do would be to just add what you wanna talk about underneath this, and leave the consent agenda as this because of there being an extra seat on planning commission.
No, I don't wanna do it that way.
Okay, alright. The hard way is.
Well, it's not the hard way.
I'll support.
Cause I want.
You'll support to amend the agenda to move the planning commission off the consent agenda into new business.
Yes.
Thank you. Roll call, right?
Yep.
Or discussion, you're.
Your discussion if you want any, or you want.
We're gonna discuss it on new business either way.
Why do we move it to new business, we're gonna discuss it now?
Yeah, we need to discuss it at new business.
Let's do roll call for the amended agenda. Would you like to approve the amended agenda, Patrick?
Yes.
Mr. Money?
Yes.
Okay, roll call please.
Whedon?
Yes.
Bianski?
Yes.
Money?
Yes.
Swam?
Yes.
Dennison?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Okay, moving down to public comment, on agenda items only. If you'd like to make a public comment, please make your way to the podium, state your name for the minutes. Anyone wishing to make a public comment?
My only comment is just that I was supposed to, I was notified short and it went to my spam email about a, meeting last week that I wasn't able to make for approval to be on the planning commission. So I just wanted to, I guess, say my piece now of why I should be on it or want to be on it, and that mainly being that I live downtown, I own property in Buchanan. I have children that go to school here, and I think that, if you have a need to fill, as you indicated at the meeting I was at for the rezoning of the house next door to me, then, I feel like I could definitely fill or help you guys fulfill that need. And I didn't get a chance to say that last week because, again, I didn't know I was supposed to be here, but if I would've known, I would've been here, so.
Okay.
Alright, thank you.
Anyone else wish to make a public comment? Okay, seeing none, let's move down to the consent agenda. So we can make a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
I will make a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
With you, report.
I'll support it.
If you want to roll call.
Bianski? Bianski?
Yes.
Money?
Yes.
Swam?
Yes.
Dennison?
Yes.
Whedon?
Yes.
Carries.
Okay, thank you. Alright, moving on to, item nine, reports by departments, committees, and boards, starting with, clerk's report.
I just have a short, quick presentation. You guys have known for a little bit, we're talking about early voting. Just trying to keep everybody updated public-wise as well as the commission. Early voting came about in 2022 with the passage by Michigan voters. Couple of the big things I highlighted, all of it is really big, but I highlighted the ones that financially impact us. So the single application to vote for absentees in all elections is a big one for us. Require state-funded absentee drop boxes, that actually took place because we had an early election. So you see the drop box outside, that is actually state-funded, so that was great for us, we didn't have to pay for it. But the big one that I want to talk to you guys about is the requirement of 9 days of early in-person voting. So that is a big financial factor for every city and township and county in the state of Michigan. I will tell you that this was a ballot proposal put on by Promote the Vote. This wasn't a state or funded, it wasn't anything from the state coming saying that they wanted 9 days. This was an actual different group. So following the adoption, Michigan Constitution requires each municipality to have at least one early voting site for statewide and federal elections. They gave us three options. You could either enter into a county agreement with other municipalities, you could enter into a municipal agreement with local municipalities near you, or you could go in by yourself and run it completely 9 days by yourself. The county actually approached us, I would say about 6 months ago, with the concept of creating two early voting sites in the county, one in North County and one in South County. The proposed sites right now for North County is at Lake Michigan College at the Todd Center in Benton Harbor. The South County is the Bering County South County building in Niles, the courthouse down there. After many meetings and discussion, 28 of the clerks out of the 30 agreed to pursue talks with the county about going into the early voting agreement. So my biggest impact was it was going to come down to finances. I figured if it was going to save money for the city for me to go by myself, I was going to do it. No matter how many hours or what it was going to take, I would find a way to do it. Well, the state has now put out $45 million for the initial cost of early voting. I don't know where they secured it from, but they have $45 million that they're offering in grant money to counties. That was the other part of the fun thing, was that the county had to submit for the grant for you. So actually Sharon Tyler, she, you know, in her past, she did economic development. She's a fantastic grant writer, so that worked out in our favor. We still have no idea how much we're gonna be awarded. We've been told it was hopefully 80% for every grant application that we would be awarded. I was in Lansing last week, and the Bureau of Elections, Jonathan Brader, he's the director, he said it was looking pretty good to be funded. He wouldn't give an exact amount, but it looked good. So we're hoping for the 80%. So if we do get the 80% of the grant awarded, we're looking at the initial cost to provide all the equipment for early voting, and one election, we're looking close to about $3,000, okay? For 100%, we're really looking at like $30, which would be great for us. Like, I would really be happy not to have to write a $30 check to the county. So, fingers crossed. I'm still thinking it's gonna be about the 80%. If we were awarded no grant money with the county, our initial cost would be close to about $2,500, I would say, with one election. I would say my initial cost is about $12,000 just to buy the equipment. So it's definitely best for us in the long haul to go with this. And this agreement is only for a year. And these are based on estimates, just talking to the vendors. The election administrator up there has worked closely with the vendors trying to get as close as price as possible. My recommendation is that you approve the resolution for myself to sign the county agreement. I will tell you, the deadline is on Wednesday. I was hoping for a little bit better numbers before I came in front of you, if we got any grant money, so we'd have a better idea. But unfortunately, with elections, everything is kind of up in the air. Another thing that factored in for me was the 9 days of going in on my own. I have a part-time elections administrator. It's incredibly long hours, it's weekends, a lot of money overtime for even just my part-time worker. You're talking about election workers and making sure I find them and staff that correctly. So I'm saying please sign the county agreement. It's cheaper for us in the long haul, and I guess if it doesn't go well, we only have this year. So we can opt out next year.
What are some of the steps that the state's taking from your perspective to help avoid fraud? Because we're all aware that this initiates a lot of opportunity for mail-in ballots to be sent to homes where individuals no longer live, if they've not communicated that.
So it puts a lot of pressure on the clerk.
Okay.
It used to be, I would say before 2018, the clerk was extremely held responsible. It's not so much nowadays, it's more on the voter for committing the fraud. I will tell you that there's checks and balances for everything. That was my biggest concern, even with early voting. The software system is actually live, so it will update me right away if somebody goes and votes in person. The hard part for me is because we do not have the staff in that, and elections is almost becoming a full-time job now with the amount that they're pushing onto the clerks. With the county agreement, I still have to be there. One of us, myself or Isabel, will have to be there to be site supervisors. So it not only takes away from my jobs as a clerk, it's extremely difficult to be in the know, and actually if one of my voters walks in here and has questions, I need to make sure that Isabel is completely trained to be able to answer those questions. We go Wednesday, we have actually Prop 2 training with the Bureau of Elections. Between legislation and trainings and how quick everything is firing off, it's nerve-wracking, but I'm capable of figuring out the checks.
I don't think the concern comes from the clerks. Like, it's my frustration with the state.
With the state.
And individuals who are willing to pass this, and now, what my understanding is, we barely got into finishing what was passed in 2018.
Correct. Correct. You just started to get, and that, like, and I was a clerk, I was a deputy then. And in 2018, that was extremely scary because they were throwing legislation as literally 2 weeks before an election, changing things on us. And it was a governor's race, and it was a lot. This is 100 times that pressure and being able to understand completely, because from what I know, my past 8 years as a clerk and running elections is completely different now. So the good thing is Isabel is new. So this is a new way, she's learning it for the first time, and she's gonna learn it the new way, where I have things in my head where, oh, I need to do this, I need to do that. I need to make sure this is totally different now for me.
So if this was put on the ballot by a private entity and had enough votes and signatures to make it happen, there is a potential that it could be reversed. I'm saying that to individuals,
because it's a constitutional change, so unfortunately,
this is why voting matters, people. No,
I completely agree with you, because there are things in that ballot initiative that I actually really liked. The active military and overseas, the postmark, they are allowed 6 days after the election, and if it comes in, I get to take it out to the canvassers and they get to count the vote. I've always agreed with military and overseas having that right to do that, because if you've ever been active duty military, it is not easy to print a ballot. It is not easy to take the time to give them that right, protect that voter. I agree with the, no harassing and all of even the Dropbox. I'm happy that it was state funded, but giving better Dropboxes for us as well. But the 9 days, there are plenty of other states that do it. They just don't do it on the level that Michigan does. Michigan is very unique to elections where local officials handle it. Mainly states are county levels that handle this. And a lot of times they don't have the leniency with absentee voters as well, like we do. My big concern is we still don't even know presidential primary is scheduled for February 27th, but we do not know if it's going to be February 27th because legislation is refusing to adjourn, and we're very up in the air about everything right now. And
we're not
going to
know for a week before.
No, we won't.
How does this work though? So you have to take your own equipment over there?
So they actually will purchase their own equipment. So my equipment is going to stay with me, which that helps us a lot, okay? So they will purchase everything with that countywide agreement. We won't be in charge of it, but there is like some maintenance costs obviously worked into that. Because our machines are maintenance by our service provider, we pay like $5,000 a year for our equipment. That's worked into the agreement with the county to pay for that.
Sounds like a lot of
shit. But ours will be staying.
Ours will stay
here. We're just renting.
So so with the 9 days of early voting, does that go up to the election day?
So it actually starts the second Saturday prior. Goes Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all the way through the week, and then it stops the Sunday, and then you have Monday in the office, and then Tuesday is election day, which is very difficult even the weekend prior, because by law, we have to hold office hours as clerks. So somehow we have to make sure that we're here in the office the weekend before the election as well. It's a lot. It's a lot. And I will tell you this, the county clerk has been absolutely fantastic with us and working together, and the clerks that have joined in, we are all hands on deck. We know that we cannot do this alone, and we have to team up to try and take this on, cost-wise, and just making sure we have enough people to do everything. One of the best ideas I've heard is actually the presidential primary. They are, because none of the township clerks are elected, so they're all on the ballot coming August and November. But they thought maybe having the clerks actually work the 9 days and figuring out the kinks so that when our workers come in and we train them, they know exactly what to look for. Because, I mean, you can't tabulate either until election night, so you need a whole other crew on election night to go to that early voting site to tabulate and canvass.
Would you mind telling us which two townships didn't agree to this collective?
Bertrand Township and, not Bertrand, sorry. Bainbridge. Thank you. Bainbridge and Benton Charter Township decided to opt out.
Bainbridge borders Benton Township.
Bainbridge, though, if you've ever lived there or visited there on election day, they treat election day like a tailgate. They are all about election day in that township, and they wanted to hold it by themselves. Me personally, I feel like that's just giving challengers and people and groups more ammo against you because they're going to be watching.
You mean geographically, where's Bainbridge Township?
Yeah, you're right.
You're right. It's like Waterloo, Coloma,
okay.
We thought it's a different county.
It's a very small jurisdiction.
You want to talk about a contested.
I just couldn't get it in my head where it's at.
This will be, it will be very interesting. I mean, I thought 2020 would probably be the hardest election I've ever gotten through between presidential, a hot race, and COVID on top of it, pandemic-wise. This will take the cake, I can guarantee that. So.
Well, thank you for everything you do, because you help educate everybody. If city and county and township clerks work as hard as you, not only us, but the community and what they are actually voting for.
I know
things would be far different. So
there's
thank you
be
for
a,
championing the cause.
There's going to be a lot more education. I have a couple of press releases lined up to go out. The county clerk is also going to hold some different voter education because this is going to be way different, and we really don't know what to expect if people are going to travel to go vote early or not. So we need to educate people that have, you know, maybe a weird schedule that want to go vote early.
I want to give you a glimmer of hope. Jonathan Lindsay, our state senator.
I know.
You know that he's leading the charge,
yep,
on declaring it unconstitutional, even though it got voted on. So Jonathan has just got elected. He's been in there boots, but the general public really needs to understand how this works. It's a constitution amendment. Whenever it becomes a constitution amendment, you have about this much of a chance,
mm-hmm,
of ever reversing it. And the Democrats did this on purpose.
Well,
I have voted absentee, I have voted for multiple different locations, and it's up to the voter to take the time to apply for an absentee ballot and make sure it gets in on time. Soldiers included, because I worked in plenty of foreign countries. So
mine always made it there.
Yeah, you did too. I only spent 6 weeks in the Navy.
Long enough sometimes.
All right, so I'd like to make a motion to approve.
I will move to approve resolution 2023-1028, authorizing city clerk into the early voting agreement with Marion County as presented.
Thank you for your support.
I'll support.
Thank you. Can we roll call first?
Money?
Yes.
Swam?
Yes.
Dennison?
Yes.
Whedon?
Yes.
Bianski?
Yes.
Motion carries. Thank you.
So much,
Cal. And good luck, Cal.
Yeah.
I might not have hair right there.
It'll be sure.
Okay, moving down to item D, community development working district.
Thanks, Mayor. Just briefly, you guys already voted on this. The title company called and they just wanted a more detailed resolution that allows city manager Ben Aldridge to represent the city at the closing. So they asked for this document, and if you could approve it, you can make sure to close.
Great. Someone can make a motion.
Sean, I'll move to approve resolution 2023-10/29 is presented.
Thank you. Your support.
This is money. I'll support.
Thank you. Your roll call, please.
Swam?
Yes.
Madison?
Yes.
Whedon?
Yes.
Bianski?
Yes.
Money?
Yes.
Carries.
Thank you. Okay, going
this is second reading for the rezoning of 208 Days Avenue, which is our milestone for the historic livery project. The Plan Commission unanimously approved recommendation to the City Commission. Our charter requires two readings. We have first reading last commission meeting. This is second reading, which would effectively change the zoning and meet our required milestone for Michigan MEDC. And if you approve this, we're hoping to report that we've cleared zoning for the historic livery project tomorrow.
Great. Does this include, is this just the building, just the livery?
This is the house next door. Okay. Livery's already in central business.
This is changing the house next door. Well, I know. I'm learning something new every day about everything. With our pursuit of residential properties, why are we going to vote? And I mean, this is going to go through as a second reading, but I still want to raise the question. We're going to tear a perfectly good house down for more parking when there's plenty of parking in front of the building, and actually Rose Street is right there, where we could do parking on Rose Street because it's closed off road anyhow. So, I mean, I have a problem with tearing a perfectly good house down when we have housing issues in the city of Buchanan. So I'll probably, even though it's been done once, I'm probably going to vote against this the second time, just because I got more information.
Isn't, just for clarity, yeah. Isn't there some research being done on actually moving that house as
yes.
well?
Yes, there is research being done on the feasibility of moving the house. We approached the preservationists with the project and explained, it's basically an argument of overall good, whereas we lose one house, the impact of the investment pulls up the entire neighborhood economically and from a historic architecture perspective, because you're saving an anchor building that will now provide value and meaning and part of the story of Buchanan across the street, down the block, around the corner. We wrote that in our findings for the approval, and that's what the Plan Commission based their approvals on. Yes, but to answer your question, they are.
Who's going to pay for that?
Excuse me?
Who's going to pay to move that house?
That's just being discussed at feasibility right now. If it can be moved, if it's cost benefit, if it makes sense.
The taxpayers aren't going to be involved in moving that house. That's what I'm asking.
I don't believe so.
No. Has the taxpayers offered up any money on your behalf?
Yeah.
Have you offered up money?
Tax. It would be a developer cost. It's not a taxpayer cost.
All right. Thank you.
Can I wait to make a motion?
This is money. I'd move to approve ordinance 2023.10/437, a zoning amendment ordinance for 208 Days Avenue as presented.
Thank you. Is there support?
I'll support.
Thank you. Good roll call.
Madison?
Yes.
Whedon?
Yes.
Jansky?
I'm going to have to vote no on this.
Money?
Yes.
Swanton?
Abstain. Business interest.
Motion carries.
Thank you. Okay, moving down to new business, we have moved the Planning Commission to consider approving Peter Lisi for a partial term ending June 2025 and Jacob Brown term ending June 2026. For discussion.
I'll move to approve Peter Lisi for a partial term ending in June 2025 and Jacob Brown term ending in June 2026 to the Planning Commission.
I want to amend that agenda to include Alan O'Brien, since I wasn't given any time to explain why I moved it.
But he just made a motion.
I know, and I just requested to make an amendment to that motion, which is done all the time.
Yeah.
Swan would have to amend the motion. If you asked him to amend it, he would have to approve.
I'll support Swan's motion.
Is he going to put it up for discussion?
Discussion.
Well, I'm going to make a motion to approve Alan Robrandt.
Can we do this motion?
Yes, we can.
Because
this is the reason why I moved it, is just because of this good old boy system that's going on down here. And I'm not going to say any names and how I do this. And this is no direct challenge to anybody that's been approved already by the Planning Commission. This is the way it was handled. This is the way it was done. There was four candidates. There's three openings. Two of the candidates were here. One was approved. one was not. All they did, they didn't ask any questions of anybody. They didn't ask any questions of anybody. They made a motion, they seconded it, they approved it. They made a motion, no second, no improvement. We had two applicants that weren't here. One was, made a motion, second, and they approved it. He wasn't even here. The other one, no, he was not. He was not here at 5 o'clock. I mean, I understand, but he was not here at 5 o'clock. The meeting was over by the time he showed up. The second applicant was not here. There was a motion made, no second, no voting. Now, we can all discuss names, but I'm not going to. But I'm not gonna sit. Everybody wants to talk about change, but nobody really wants to do anything about change. I attended a meeting yesterday for the Preservation Society, and it was an hour and a half of nothing but praise for one of the applicants. Nothing but praise from serious people from the community. So I told y'all, this is not just personal, this is the good old boy system, hard at work, very hard at work. So that's all I got to say about it.
I'm going to take the call for the actual motion, yep. And then you can make your yep. motion.
I would like a second, and then you guys can vote whatever way you want to. You don't have to vote yes or no if you second it.
So we have a motion, and we have support for Peter Lisi and Jacob Brown. Okay, roll call, please.
Wait.
Yes.
Bianski.
No.
Money.
Yes.
Well.
Yes.
Fast.
Yes.
Motion carries.
Thank you.
Now, if you would like to make your
motion. I'm going to make the motion that we appoint Helen LeBrant to the Plan Commission out of necessity, and that's something I forgot in my discussion. We still have an opening. They had four candidates. They could have filled all three openings. We have been two candidates shy of a full Plan Commission for 2.5 years, even though I begged before I became a commissioner. Why not? I even applied for it, but I'm on that hit list too. Because, you know, I don't lay down, I'm not a minion, and I guess that's my motion. I'll shut up before, you took your light away, Ben. Somebody steal it?
Okay, we have a motion, is there support?
You guys aren't even gonna support, so you can vote. Support my motion, and then vote no.
You just called us all minions.
So what?
Not hurt by it. You can say what you want to say. I'm okay. I appreciate it.
Anyone wants to make a motion? Pardon me, and support the motion from the floor. Okay, hearing none, the motion dies.
I think it's absolutely pathetic.
Moving down to communications, the Buchanan Riverfront Master Plan Public Workshop on October 24th, 2023, 5 p.m. Yes. Just give us a little.
Sure. We have a public meeting tomorrow, 5 o'clock here at City Hall. We invite all members of the public to come down and give your vision of enhancement of public access along the St. Joseph River in Buchanan. Prior to that meeting, there will be a neighborhood meeting with the Northside Neighborhood Group on the same topic. The project, as you remember, is being managed by Avin Marsh, the engineering consultant. The entire project was funded by AEP, the power company, so none of the dollars came from city coffers. So it's been a great public engagement project, and we're going to talk about how the St. Joseph River, its relationship with Buchanan, can be enhanced for a better and more meaningful experience for people that live here and people that visit. So it's exciting. I encourage everyone to come for the meeting. There'll be interactive maps where we can sit in groups, and there'll be facilitators where you can come up and give your ideas. All the ideas will be captured and brought back to the steering committee, and then they'll will be refined. And then there'll be another public meeting scheduled to advance the different themes and topics that have been discussed and proposed by the community. So, very excited.
Who's on the steering committee?
Ben. There's 8 or 9 members on the steering committee. Mayor is on there. Jerry Flanner, George Bjunk, Mike Rowland, who else, Mayor?
Frida.
Jeannie Harris. Is Peter on it? I can get you a list, yeah. But there's a really amazing group of Buchanan people on it, and it's been an exciting project, so.
Is this part of the St. Joseph County River St. Joe, St. Joe River? Because I've contacted them too.
Yeah, no, it's, this involves a discussion on the land that the city of Buchanan controls. So our public access areas.
Thank you.
Perfect, thank you. Okay, moving down to public comment on non-agenda items. If you'd like to make a motion, or I'm sorry, if you'd like to make a comment on a non-agenda item, please make your way to the podium, state your name and address.
Good evening, my name is Monroe, I'm from 118 Sherman Parkway. I wasn't planning on talking tonight, but there is something that Commissioner Bianski said that I feel that we all need to hear. There is an old boys club in Buchanan, and I do feel that we often vote in our volunteers who are willing to work for free based on whether we like them as human beings or not, and that should not be how we do business. We should be voting them in for what they bring to the table and for their qualifications. And being that I can't mention anything from the agenda, I will just leave it at that, because I really do feel that there are some people that are very well qualified for that position, and they were not considered because they don't like their personalities. So thank you for that argument. I will ask for one more thing. Sorry. I will ask for your prayers, the entire room, for my family that's in Israel. They are in dire need of prayer. Just 2 weeks ago, my best friend lost his 2 children. And right now, my family is right in the middle of it all. So I ask that you consider them in your prayers. Thank you.
Anyone else wish to make a public comment?
Regarding Channel 17, has that been looked at any as far as maintenance? It is not coming in clear.
Last one, I thought you fixed it.
We fixed it. We spent months on it. Ms. Norma actually helped us get Comcast in here and sat with them all day, and it still doesn't work. It refuses to work.
I will.
No matter what we do, it doesn't work.
Anyone else wish to make a public comment? Okay, seeing none, let's move on to executive comments, city manager.
Just for informational purposes, a small committee has been formed to work on bringing the 1863 pumper, which is currently stored at MSU, back to Buchanan. This is not an official city committee, but at some point I'm sure we'll be asking for the city commission for your support in the form of a letter. The committee is made up of representatives from the library, Friends of Oak Ridge Cemetery, fire department, and myself. And if you have any questions or want to know how to get involved, please contact Peter Alisi. He is the man headed up.
Peter, I'll be in contact. Feedback while I'll just keep moving the ball forward on that.
brought up when I was a commissioner before. This is just another one of them long-time dreams, Ben. I apologize for the time that you're going to have to spend on it. I'm very upset that I come down here to a zoning commission meeting and they conducted yourselves the way they do. This is not anything about personalities. That's why I didn't mention any names. The fact that they did it, no comments, elected, and I know Jake, and I've talked to all four of the candidates now. I know two of them quite well, and that's why it was pretty difficult to not vote for Peter. I've met Jake because he's on Barb now. I think he's going to be a very strong attribute. I reached out and I talked to Matt over the weekend, but Matt had an email screw up. Jake showed up late. The meeting was already over. But the point being is Jake was put on the commission, and we need Northside representatives, so that was a given, but he needed to be here, so they could have moved that out. We had three empty spots, and the commission failed to fill all three. After 2.5 years of having two empty spots, and I put the blame directly on the director for that. Thank you very much.
Mr. Lee.
Thank you to this commission for everything that they do. I know we've been working hard on different things, and that's basically all I've got. I got one question for Mike. Wake up. is there going to be any, I want to go on record, is there going to be any change in policies, how we get leaves to the curbsides, or are we still placing leaves on the
tree lawns?
Tree lawns?
It's against the MS4 permit to put them in the street.
Okay.
I will not recommend anybody for putting them in the street when it's time, but it does make the drains plug up and it is harder. It takes us a lot of time to get them off the curb. I spent all day raking leaves off the curb into the street so we could pick them up today.
And so, yeah, and that was a question that was brought to me, and I says, well, I'll talk to Mike, and this is a good place to do it because now it goes on public record, and you know that you would still prefer them to be on the tree lawn, but we know you're coming down the street.
Yeah.
Pull them off yourself so you don't tear up my front yard.
Yep.
With the tractor. Okay.
It makes it a lot easier if they're just in the street, but we can't do it for the MS4 permit because of the rain and the drains and all that good stuff. So it makes it, the street's a mess if they're in the street and they get in the drains and the water stays.
How much does it cost us to clean the drains up? Because I have neighbors that fail to leave it in their yard, and I'm very adamant. It really bothers me when they break them in the streets because the storm drains get blocked up and then you got water backing up.
Well, the best part of leaves and that sort of stuff is it plugs the top of them.
Right.
So it never goes inside the thing. We can just come and scrape it off and move along. But when it rains and there's a heavy rain event like coming Wednesday, then we're going to get 1.5 inches of rain in the morning is what they're saying. We spend hours cleaning drains, and there'll be multiple drains. I mean, the trees put enough leaves in the street to plug the drains if we get enough water.
You're going to wait another week and a half?
We have been out for about 2 weeks, hit and miss. If we see piles out, we'll go out and run a route. We were in 5 of the 6 neighborhoods today. We did not get the last neighborhood over by the high school, but we were in every other neighborhood today, raking and blowing and pulling leaves out of gutter pans and ditches and, yep.
And you're no longer picking up bags.
We are no longer picking up bags. That was done, and bags and brush were done the first week of October, second week of October.
And just for the public too, as well as myself, where does that, at the city landfill?
So if you drive in there and talk to them, they will tell you, just follow that. Everyone else, I believe, is going up on the hill right now with their garbage, and you'll go around the edge, and there'll be a big pile of bags that they turn over, and it composts. It's a free dump. They don't charge you anything to dump that stuff. So along with your brush, they do not charge you to dump your brush. So
just need to have it covered when you go up.
It does have to be covered.
I just want to reiterate that because I'm obviously, I have
saw yours this morning, and I said, oh, Mark,
don't worry, I saw it.
I'm gonna see you tonight, and I forgot till
I was a good resident, and I listened to the message, and I didn't love you.
I also wanted to bring up, the cemetery has got the new markers for the sections, and the cemetery crew did get those put out. Our cemetery board purchased those at a cost, and we had them made up, and so they are now out there. Mike and the cemetery crew got them put on posts. I guess they cut the posts, painted the posts, and so that looks really nice out there. With the old fire truck that's or pumper unit that's coming into town, yeah, that's going to be, you know, we discussed that on our cemetery board. That's how it got started. Norma brought it to us, and we did know years ago that that had been pushed out of their historical department and shoved under some bleachers. So I think that was the main reason why we wanted to try to get a hold of that and bring it back to Buchanan. Right now, we may or may not have a place to put it, but if we get it back here, then we can surely find a place to put it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Not there either.
First, I'd like to.
I think it's very hard. I think
it's very hard. I would like to say how nice it is to see Chief Burnett here tonight. It's been a while. Glad to see you. Secondly, the five of us are up here to make decisions based on our professional and the experiences we've had. And occasionally, we're asked to appoint people to boards based on recommendations from other boards. And I have no qualm saying that if I feel like someone isn't going to be a good team member or isn't going to make a board function well, then I don't have to appoint anyone. And if you don't like that, you can run for office and you can make the decisions. That being said, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
I have one more comment if I could. And
sure.
I'm not the one on my thing. Just for informational purposes, I don't know if you know Pat Fellows, who is a lieutenant on our fire department. I got a message yesterday that he went into cardiac arrest and respiratory arrest, is being transferred to St. Joe ICU at St. Joe. And the update we just got, he had an angiogram this afternoon to check the blockages and look at his heart muscle. The doctor said there's actually